Good evening. Good evening. Welcome to the September 28th Valley View School Board meeting. Thanks for that spirited introduction by this whoever put that thing together. I like the new music. Anyway, where are we at? Who would like to read the board affirmation statement? Just got it up.
How about the pledge?
Oh, I'm sorry. Pledge of Allegiance first. Mr. Medeiros, would you lead us, ask everybody to rise and lead us in the pledge?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our mission is to empower all learners to be college and career ready and to develop, grow, and achieve as productive citizens.
Dr. Mitchum, agenda.
Yes, Mr. President, I'd like to ask that the board approve the agenda as presented.
Motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Motion seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Ayes have it. Consent agenda. Dr. Mitchum.
Yes, Mr. Quigley, I'd like to ask the board to approve consent agenda items 5-1 through 5-6, 5-1 board meeting minutes September 14, 2015, 5-2 executive session meeting minutes September 14, 2015, 5-3 gifts for Bolingbrook second and third grade classrooms, Jamie McGee Elementary School and R.C. Hill Elementary School, 5-4 student activity contract approval request, Irene King Elementary with Interstate Studio for a three-year contract, 5-5 student activity contract approval request, Scholastic Books with the following schools, R.C. Hill Elementary, Independence Elementary, and Jane Addams Middle School, and 5-6 Illinois State Board of Education report on shared services of outsourcing 2015. I'd like to ask that these be approved as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, seeing none. Roll call vote, please.
Member Medeiros?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
President Quigley?
Yes. Pillars, I don't have a copy of who's doing what, so if you have it.
First up would be Mr. Kinder from RHS. With Principal Kinder from RHS with Mr. Medeiros.
Member Medeiros?
JT, you'll be presenting a pen.
Go that way.
Where's Krista? Krista, come on up. And the rest of them. We have the rest of the administrative team here with us as well to acknowledge Krista. Good evening, President Quigley, members of the board, Dr. Mitchum, senior leadership, members of the audience, and members of the community. Before I go through the actual reading for the pillar, I just want to say that this is a long time coming for Mrs. Simpson, and anyone that knows her in our community is that she's very well known and she's very busy with all of our student leadership activities and government, and with homecoming being in week 4 and already in the books, this was really probably the first night in 2 years on a Monday evening that we've been able to pull her in to acknowledge her for all of her great things that she's been able to do over all of her years here at RHS. So it's an honor to recognize Mrs. Krista Simpson, a special education teacher at Romeoville High School. Krista encompasses the qualities of an individual who is a true pillar of Valley View School District. Krista provides unwavering support to the students that she works with each day and demonstrates leadership among the staff and students. Krista goes above and beyond her responsibilities to recognize student strengths and meet the academic and social-emotional needs of her students. Krista holds high expectations for all students and has established a culture of learning in her resource classes where students display continuous ownership for their learning and successes. In addition to the supports that Krista provides to the students in her classroom, Krista also serves as our assistant activities director and leadership sponsor. In these roles, Krista works tirelessly to plan school-wide activities to provide our students with opportunities to work together as a student body for a common goal. The amazing events and activities planned by Krista and her peers are remembered by our students as some of their most memorable experiences while at RHS. Krista continues to take the initiative in leading and coordinating unique student activities. Her hard work in planning and organizing ensure that these activities always exceed the successes from previous years. The excitement and energy that she creates among staff and students has unquestionably cultivated a culture where students and staff are proud to be called Spartans. So without further ado, Mrs. Krista Simpson.
Come on up and take a picture. Come on up here and take a picture. Come on up, guys. Get a picture with your mom. Come on. There you go. Get in there.
And also, just before I give up the microphone, Major Beerley from our ROTC group left an invitation at each of your desks for our Marine Corps Ball, which will be November 6th, celebrating the Marine Corps' birthday, which is November 10th. So that is also at your desk.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Laverty, I finally got my sheet up.
Good evening, school board, Dr. Mitchum, senior leadership. This person that is receiving the Valley View Schoolship District Pillar from Humphrey is Pamela Stevens. Pam has been at Humphrey since 2007. Pam has taken on several roles in the past 5 years while at Humphrey. She's been our applied tech teacher, our enhancement teacher, a math teacher, and currently back to math enhancement teacher. Outside of her education role, Pam coaches girls basketball and girls volleyball. She's also our yearbook sponsor. As yearbook sponsor, Pam attends every event and activity that our students participate in and does a great job developing a great product for our yearbook, which she puts together through our print shop, through the district print shop, and it's really a great, great item. She's also our staff technology coach, as well as our staff representative for the new stages evaluation program. She is also a sponsor for our technology club that she works with the students every Friday. It's an honor to work with her every day, and it's an honor to have honor to name her as Humphrey's Pillar of Valley View.
Thank you. Liaison reports from my right. Liaison reports from my left.
Just a couple of quick announcements with regards to Wilco Area Career Center. At our last board meeting, Mack and Associates supplied Wilco with their annual financial report, and it's nice to know that they found absolutely no findings. It's a 45-page document, but two sentences was that it was there was no findings and everything was very well put together. Also tomorrow night, Wilco is offering their open house from 6 to 8 p.m. The address is 500 Wilco Boulevard in Romeoville. Come and attend. You get a chance to tour, see some of the classrooms, talk to some of the staff members and teachers there. It's a very, very interesting, and some of the different departments have a variety of contests to try and be the most recognized and popular school portion. So it's a fun event. So if you get a chance, come out tomorrow night from 6 to 8. Thank you.
Thank you. Any others?
Last week, Member Peril, Member Campbell, and I attended the forklift rodeo. It was great. If you ever get a chance to come to it, it's amazing what they can do. And like we said, one of the forklift was, and the only girl there, is a graduate of Valley View. And so it was an amazing event to go to. If you get a chance to get there, please do so. Mr. Kinder and Mr. Mitchum were there also. It's something to see.
Thank you. Any others? That it? Thank you. Audience participation, anybody who wishes to address the board this evening, please step forward and state your name.
Hi, I'm Mike Baker from the Sears Logistics Distribution Center. Thank you, Ms. Sikora, for talking about the forklift rodeo. That's why I'm here, too.
The head rodeo guy, whatever you call that guy.
So thank you for letting me come up here and speak. I wanted to first of all, thank the members of the board that did show up to the forklift event. I hope you enjoyed it. Mr. Bedaris, Ms. Campbell, and Ms. Paro and Ms. Sikora, and of course Dr. Mitchum was there. Thank you for being there. And a special thank you for Derek Kinder. I'd like to read this letter from Sears, if I don't mind.
Absolutely.
Thank you. The Sears Holding Distribution Center in Romeoville would like to thank you for your participation and support during our 2015 National Logistics Lift Truck Rodeo event. This event that we hold has become one of the most highly anticipated events of the year for our contestants and our senior leadership team from Hoffman Estates. One of the main reasons this event has been so successful year after year is the support and participation we receive from the Romeoville High School students and staff. I know that I do not need to tell you this, however, you truly have an amazing group of students. From the ROTC members who escorted our contestants into the venue and so proudly presented our country's flag, while another student, Allie Rosendahl, performed our national anthem, to the jazz band and the drum line who were fan favorites and absolutely spectacular. We also want to thank the TV Media Arts Club led by Mr. Jack Randich for videotaping and broadcasting the event across the United States and Puerto Rico so that all of our friends and families could watch and cheer on their favorite contestant. Last but certainly not least, we would like to thank Principal Derek Kinder, Dr. Mitchum, and the Valley View School Board for allowing your students to be part of this event and cultivating the spirit of community involvement. The students of today are our leaders of tomorrow for all of us. Sincerely, Mike Baker, General Manager, Sears.
Thank you.
We hope to see all of you there next year.
I would have been there this year, but I was out of town.
The representative from Romeoville High School, out of 16 contestants, she took third place. So.
On a side note, while Sandy's coming up, I had a chance to tour one of the facilities that's in the district today, G&W Electric. It was a professional thing for me. But when you meet the business owners, the presidents, CEOs, general managers of these facilities that are in our community and in our district, they could not be more fantastic about their community involvement. And I just want to acknowledge that and thank you so much. And there's a lot more just like him that are out there that support things in our community, and that should be acknowledged. But thank you in particular for involving us, and we really appreciate that. So thank you.
You're welcome to come by anytime.
Thanks. Can I drive a forklift? Come on.
Gotta have a license.
Yes. Welcome back, a retired teacher from the Valley View School District, retired member of the Village Board of Bolingbrook, Sandy Swinkunas.
Not anymore.
I said retired.
Well, retired from the village. Anyway,
yeah, from both.
Sandy Swinkunas, previously, you're right, a teacher in the Valley View School District. Good evening to everybody, and thank you for giving me this opportunity. I'm here tonight as chair of the 50th Anniversary Committee in Bolingbrook. If you have not seen some of our activities, they're kind of over, so I can't invite you to come. But when we first started this project, I started numbering the agendas, and 1 month we met twice, and my last agenda was 21. So we met 20 months to prepare for this year, and I think we've really accomplished a lot of neat things. I had a wonderful committee, a few of them are sitting on the back row with me, and a great Public Works Department in Bolingbrook that helped us put it all together, along with our mayor and trustees that okayed everything that we came up with. As a retired teacher, one of the things that, while I was teaching, that I always had a little bit of a problem with was when I got to the community section in our social studies book, I was studying a community in Texas called Humble. Now, I have no idea where it is, never did look it up, except it was on the little map. But why are we studying a community that the kids have no idea where it is or why we're doing it? Why don't we do something for ourselves and study Bolingbrook? So I would pull in some things, I'd go over and pick up some stuff. But when this committee met and we started listing things that we wanted to do, one of the things that was on my list was to do some kind of, not so much a history book, but a community book on Bolingbrook, and put this together for the second and third graders of our district so that we can study what we're doing and not what somebody else is doing. Little side note, I went to a reunion about 2 years after that, and two of my classmates, not married, live in Humble, Texas. True story.
Are they humble?
Joy, where are you? Humble. Adolph, where are you? Humble. I was like, oh my gosh, how did that happen? But anyway, so one of the things we did, and when I say we formed a committee, and the committee was of two, and it was Kathy Booley and Diane Perrell. And Kathy became more involved with the history book, and most of it was left to Diane. In the end, Michael Carpizano came around and helped Diane with some things, but we have put together an anniversary book, or a community book, on the village of Bolingbrook. And Diane has done a phenomenal job with this. We went through a lot of reprints. For the 25th, there was a coloring book kind of thing that was made, and it was really primitive, and I just really wanted to build on that. And if you want to make it coloring, okay, but then what do we do? So it ended up that Michael was able to take out color from snapshots, which, you know, I'm not a tech person at all, which just blew my mind. So the kids can color it if they want to, but I'll let Diane tell you how she went through and processed this.
Thank you, Sandy. So I have my community member hat on now. But we, like she said, we did this for the second and third grade students in Bolingbrook Schools. And it was really exciting when I took them to the schools, because I'd go into the classroom and I'd hold this up and I'd say to the kids, who knows what this is? And at least 90% of the hands shot up, and they're like, oh, they all knew. So it was really exciting for me to see that they had an instant connection. They recognized what was going on in our community this summer, and, or well, more than this summer, but they were real quick to point out, oh yeah, and there's the big 5-0s and the water fountains, and there's at the village picnic, they had a big cake, and the kids were telling me all about it. So what was neat was, like Sandy said, they have to learn about whatever this little town is in their textbook, because it's their curriculum. But this is a supplement that I think once they got that connection, then they were probably real excited to read it and to learn about the community that they live in. It tells about schools, it tells about sports, parks and recreation, village services, village government, police and fire, shops and restaurants, churches, library. It's about 12 or 13 different chapters, so to speak. So anyway, it was really neat for our kids, and I think it would be really awesome if there was somebody in the Romeoville community who may be familiar enough with Romeoville, because it's not me, that could do something like this for our Romeoville students, because I think the Bolingbrook students really are going to benefit from this.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And for those of you who may have joined us late, it's not a special appearance by Paula Dean, that's actually St. Ace McCunas. And also, just to acknowledge the president of the Fountaindale Library, Peggy Danhoff, was part of the committee. Hi, Peg. Thanks for coming.
Sandy, before you leave, you started with the humble beginnings of Bolingbrook.
Ba-dum-bum. Hello.
Hi. I'm Char Doring. I'm a staff member at Brooks Middle School. And the reason that I'm here tonight is because one of my students is been in Lurie's Children's Hospital since June. We're hoping that he can return, however his prognosis is guarded at this time. He's gone through several procedures. He is suffering from leukemia, and we are told that his cancer is probably back. It's with a heavy heart that I ask you for your support and help, that if it's okay to send out an email to the rest of the staff. We have been doing fundraising for his family because right now his mother is unable to work with the FMLA. So we have made Hector's Heroes t-shirts, and we also have, thanks to Dr. Mitchum, and we really appreciate you allowing us to go to the VHS game on Friday, we were able to raise $775 for the Delgado family. So we're just asking for your support and permission to be able to take this district-wide so that we can offer, as a community, more support to the Delgado family.
Motion to approve?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Done.
Thank
you. Send me a t-shirt and I'll send you some money. How about that?
I will do that. Absolutely.
Or how about I just send you some money and you keep the t-shirt and give it to somebody else?
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I would like to thank Bolingbrook High School Friday night at their home game. The game itself wasn't that interesting, but unfortunately. But especially Mr. Rob Rose with the 50-50 and everything else helping support that. So thanks to Bolingbrook High School. And I think, Shar, if you send, I'm not going to speak for everybody, but I think if you send us all information on where we need to go, I think somebody, everybody up here will reach in their pocket.
Thank you. Next. Where are we at on here? Number 9, student due process cases. Dr. Mitchum.
Yes, I ask that you approve student due process cases A through D as amended.
So moved.
Motion.
Second.
Motion seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, seeing none. Roll call vote, please.
Member Boudouris.
Yes.
Member Campbell.
Yes.
Member Felice.
No.
Member Perro.
Yes.
Member Sikora.
Yes.
Vice President Hanson.
Yes.
President Quigley.
Yes. Action reports, Ms. Kinder.
No report this evening.
Thank you. Mr. Grazafi, at this time I would ask that we go into adjourn into public hearing for discussions on the budget. Motion?
So moved.
Second.
Motion seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Mr. Grazafi, if you will please present the budget, which is probably not much different than what you presented a few weeks ago.
That is very close to accurate. For those of you that may not know me, my name is Gary Grazafi. I'm the Assistant Superintendent for Administrative Services. Tonight we'll be presenting the final draft of the 2015-2016 budget. Changes for 15-16 budget overall were $256 million. That includes our $25 million debt service payment, but it does not include the $53.6 million TRS on behalf payment. You may notice that that number, $53 million, is quite a significant increase from where it's been in the past. That's due to a change per our auditor that requires that we book, if you will, the on-behalf payment that the state pays on behalf of Valley View. And for the first time ever, they're requiring the number, the amount to represent the actual dollar figure and not a formula or percentage that was used in the past. And so for those of you that have heard me present the budget before, it is a pass-through. We don't actually receive the money, we just book it on the revenue side and we book it on the expenditure side. I don't like to put it in the budget because it takes our 256 up over $300 million, and for me it's really just a book entry and really doesn't cross our desk in any way, shape, or form. But we are required to book it in the budget. From an operational perspective, we're $226 million, or an increase of a little over $1 million from FY15 budget. That's not actual, but that's from last year's budget, a little over 0.5%. Revenue, corporate personal property replacement tax. When we presented the budget on August 10th, we did not know what we were estimated to receive. The Department of Revenue had posted the estimated receipts, and we're happy to report that we're a $304,000 increase over the prior year, or 3%. That represents about $10.4 million of revenue for the district annually. General state aid budgeted for an increase of $3.8 million. The property tax levy, about $1 million increase, 50% of which would be applied to FY16. We are restricted in what we can increase our tax levy by, CPI or 5%, whichever is less. In this case, it's 0.8%. So that is what the tax cap legislation restricts our tax levy to. And so that's what has been incorporated into the budget. The other large piece, $896,000 for the pre-K expansion grant. That was not included in the draft budget or preliminary budget. We have incorporated it on both the revenue and expenditure side, so really not just a net zero change, if you will. Expenses, 3% per our labor agreements, totals to about $4.1 million. Benefits are budgeted for a decrease of 4.5% in claim costs, negotiated plan design changes, and the implementation of working spouse eligibility provision. Along with that, we've added $570,000 as a one-time $1,000 offset for that spousal ineligibility provision, and we'll probably hit that number right on the head. ERO costs budgeted at $300,000. Tuition for outside placement students is actually reduced by $340,000. The guest teacher rate, we've got a $200,000 placeholder in there. If you don't know already, it's a real challenge filling substitution or guest teacher spots locally, statewide, nationally. And so we've had some discussion about what we might do to make ourselves more attractive, and so I wanted to put something in the budget should that change occur. Post-retirement incentives budgeted for just over $1 million. Within that line item would be the 6% enhancements for those that are in the retirement track, any post-retirement severance, as well as any insurance subsidies post-retirement. And then lastly, increase of $1.6 million in our scheduled debt service payment, or a 6.2% increase. And that's really in line, keeping with what it's been over the last 5 years since we refinanced our debt back in 2010. The changes since the budget was put on display back in August, we've added 3 teachers and 2 aides. We've added the pre-K expansion grant, as I mentioned earlier. We reduced our budget transfer from transportation to the education fund by $460,000. That's due to trying to balance the transportation fund and not having take out more than we should. We had reduced the general state aid calculation by $262,000 per the final computations from the State Board of Ed. We were notified we're receiving $38,000 and $283,000 respectively for the IDEA and special education orphanage reimbursements. I spoke earlier about the TRS on behalf payment. That's a $14 million change. Again, really won't affect our operations, but it is required to be booked. And lastly, we did reclassify Title I salaries to allow to local funding to allow for the Decision Ed software purchase, which I think was approved at our last meeting, with really not increasing anything in our overall budget. That was something that Rachel Kinder and myself worked through, along with Director of Finance Borg, to really come up with a way to allow us to make that purchase without hitting our bottom line. Our sources of revenue, really not a whole lot to report here in terms of what you've seen in the past. If you include that on behalf payment, it looks like we're paying 60% and the state's picking up 34%. But when you back it out, we're at 73% locally funded, 21% from the state, and 6% for the Fed, for our overall revenue stream of $253 million. Just to give you some sense of what it looks like over the past 5 years, again, excluding that on behalf payment, locally, the residents and businesses, corporations are paying 75% of the operational cost of the school district. Again, probably a little bit on the low side when you compare it to some of the other collar counties, but again, still a pretty heavy burden to carry for our local residents. The state, you can see it's a slight uptick in the last couple years. That's primarily due to the state general state aid formula. With property taxes declining, the state aid formula dictates more revenue in terms of general state aid, but overall on an average less than 20%, 18.6% from the state, and the federal kicking in about 6% pretty much across the board.
It should be noted that is, we're probably the lowest in the country.
We very well may be.
I know we're in the bottom 3 or 4 of what the state provides for education in Illinois.
I've seen 50, 49, 48.
We're right exactly in the right. Yep. Bottom 2 or 3. So.
General state aid proration, again, a little bit to your point, Steve, in that over the years, our entitlement, the formula, has generated a considerable amount of money, $142 million over the last 5 years. Here are the prorations, including this year's proration of a little over 92%. And so really the important figure here is that we have lost $13 million of general state aid formula funding due to the state not having enough money in the coffers to go around. And then when you marry that with the transportation for regular and vocational proration, On average, we're receiving $1.1 million less than our expenses in terms of what the formula should generate. Over those 6 years, I think it was, that's $6.6 million. And so you add those two together, we've got $20 million that we don't have in our bank account due to proration. And that's been, you know, a large part of our issue in terms of deficit spending. It's really hard to cover that when you just don't have the revenue to support the services that we provide. This gives you an idea of where the budget expenses are. You can see here it's broken down by salaries, benefits, purchase services, supplies and capital outlay, other objects, non-capitalized equipment, and post-retirement benefits. Across the board, we're at 3.2% increase. This does include our debt service payment that was going up 6.2% or $1.5 million. The education fund is budgeted for a 1.9% increase from last year's actual. This would be based on from last year's actual to this year's budget. As I provided back in August, for the first time in 5 years, we've got a balanced budget. We're actually generating a small surplus of $1.3 million. When you take that against the operational budget of $226 million, not a whole lot, but again, I'll take anything we can get. And so we're roughly 2% change in fund balance. I think when I presented in August, we were at 109 days. When we had some adjusting entries, our starting balance actually declined. We were at 66 up here, now we're at 64. So we're still at 106 days of operational reserves, if you will. At the time, I think we mentioned that 90 days is our bare minimum. So we're actually better than we were at this time last year, and we hope to continue that trend, and the five-year forecast would indicate that we are indeed starting to plateau. I do remain very guarded, cautiously optimistic with the state at least setting our finances and all of education budget with approving that budget, but until they get their full house in order, anything could happen. And as I mentioned, I think at our last meeting, or at the budget preliminary budget meeting, they prorated us twice last year, and that was the first time that's happened in the 20 years I've been doing this. And so that was a real watershed moment, and so that could happen again. And if it does, there's not a whole lot we can do when you're in the middle of a fiscal year, other than try to plan, you know, plan accordingly. So again, good news for the first time in some time. I also like to close out with our 10-year fund balance history. It might be a little bit hard to read for those of you in the audience, but it is it will be up on the website, and it is in the board members' packets. And so, you know, over time, we have had a high point balance of almost $120 million back in 2008. And of course, that's when the recession hit, and the economy started turning for the worst. And so we steadily declined. We had a big decrease here in 12 to 13. That was when we added the additions for full-day kindergarten. And then slowly we've been trending in that 90-day, 100-day window. Last year we actually brought it up by a few million dollars in 2015, and we're hoping to add to that in 2016. Again, it's good to see the ship being righted, if you will. We have not really had to slash services to the point where most families or students would notice, and so that's a good thing.
And that's something I'd like to comment on. We have, in my opinion, through the stewardship of Gary, the administration, and this board and previous boards, we have weathered the storm without mass layoffs, without interruption in services, without a lot of cuts to programs and what other, and trust me, there are other districts around here who have done that. We have tried to manage what we charge for fees and keep that at a livable level. And in the midst of all this, because we thought it was the right thing to do, we went to all-day kindergarten. And anybody that's up here who voted on that, I know Liz and I did, they should be commended for that as well, because that was the right thing to do for the district, right thing to do for the first year, 1,100 families that took advantage of it, or 1,100 kids, I don't know how many families, but all of that, and not having to face what some of the other districts, I mean, there were districts who were riffing 1,000 teachers. And we didn't do that. We didn't upset people's lives. And I think, and to be quite frank, Gary should be commended, because he does guess on the cautiously optimistic side, but to be able to steer through this, and Jim and your administration with the guidance and all that, I think I certainly appreciate the efforts and the candor behind the scenes that you know, the general public necessarily doesn't see. But when we have questions about how things are going to work or what's this going to look like in 2, 3, 4, 5 years, Gary has given us very good numbers, something that we're comfortable living with and not going below to being a borrowing district like others. There are districts who borrow money from us at the end of the year to make payroll. Of course, we charge them a small percentage for that, as we should, because Gary's good at that. But the point is, we did not have to do that. We did borrow from our rainy day fund, and that's the purpose of a rainy day fund. And hopefully that has flatlined, as you've shown, starting to creep up a little bit. So I certainly want to acknowledge some of the things that have gone on in the past 4, 5, 6 years since this, you know, economy's been what it is, 2008 to now, 7 years. So thank you.
You're quite welcome. I think when Dr. Mitchum took the helm, he was in for a bit of an awakening when we sat in the staffings that begin in February and March and saw what some of our class sizes are. And they have not changed much since that time. We have held the line. We've been able to keep our class sizes at a very enviable level. I hear, you know, colleagues whose friends, wives, what have you, teach in other districts, and ask them, first thing I ask them, what's your class size? And, you know, they're at 30, they're at 32, they're at 28, and this is in the second grade class. And so, you know, we're not there. I appreciate meeting of the minds, if you will, the compromise in terms of making sure that kids first. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention Joanne Borg, who is the director of finance for the district, who is very instrumental in assembling what is a rather complicated budget. She does it with with aplomb. I don't give her a lot of time sometimes. I ask for a lot of things in short notice, but I feel really good about where we are. I do feel also that, as I mentioned in the past, this is a worst case budget. This would be every line item being spent to zero, and that rarely happens. And so, barring any catastrophic news coming out of Springfield, most likely we'll end the year better than what's projected there. I always like to give you, you know, what I feel is the worst case scenario. So I think that's important to make note of as well.
Thanks, Gary. Anybody else have any questions of Gary while we're? This is a public hearing. If anybody would like to address, please come up and state your concerns, questions, comments. State your name, please. Hang on. Go to the mic. Come on, Bob.
Hey, guys. I know some of you here. My name is Robert Leach. I'm a resident here. And both my children, who are both now in college, have come 100% through Valley View since kindergarten all the way up. So I'm here today kind of off topic. I was happy to see some of the great numbers that we have as a community leader. I write for a local newspaper. I was instrumental in developing the Bugle, as most of you guys know here, right, for the Times Weekly. And I also spend a lot of time around the schools, volunteering, helping out. I just believe, and I always have, maybe it's the way I was raised, that our school district and our schools in general are extremely important to my property value.
Mr. Leach, I'm sorry.
Yes.
If you have a comment that's not germane to this, the budget, that would be at 19.3, announcements by the public, but we have to close the budget then allow you to speak.
Okay, and, sorry, well then I jumped the gun a little bit.
Yeah, you jumped it just a little bit. If you just give us a few minutes, we'll let you have the podium.
All right.
Promise.
Okay. All right, I'll sit down.
All right.
Thanks, Bob. Anyone else? Hearing none, seeing none, a motion to close the budget hearing would be in order.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. The ayes have it. At this point, if there's no question or comments by the board, a motion would be in order to pass the budget as presented by Assistant Superintendent Grisafi and Superintendent Mitchell.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and seconded. Madam Clerk, since we're spending an enormous amount of money, a roll call vote will be in order.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrill?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
President Quigley?
Yes.
Final action to report this evening for me is the presentation of a contract for snow removal and salting at Bolingbrook High School. As we mentioned in the information report at our last board meeting, we were out for bid, advertised on September 4th, and bids were open on September 18th. We did receive 5 responses. Unfortunately, the incumbent provider was late to the bid opening, and we could not accept their bid. We did review the bids and are recommending the low bidder at this time, Brancato Landscaping, for a one-year contract for Bolingbrook High School with the option to extend for 2016-17 and 17-18 if the services are up to par. Estimated value, again, depending on snow conditions, $43,565. Again, recommending the approval of that one-year contract with Brancato Landscaping.
Motion?
So moved. Second.
Motion and second. Somebody.
Whatever.
Any discussion on the snow removal contract?
I'd just like to say thank you, Mr. Grisafi, for answering my questions last week. I had some questions in regards to the incumbent and their location and their proposal, and I appreciate you answering those, but they answered my questions very thoroughly. I appreciate that.
And it's no small thing when there's issues with the snow removal at any of the schools, we hear about it pretty quickly. So, and it doesn't matter if it's in-house or out-of-house. But in the last few years, I've been a champion of our staff for getting the buildings open in the big snowstorms that we've had. It's been fantastic. So please pass that along. We have a motion. We have a second. Roll call vote, please.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
President Quigley?
Yes. Next up, Ms. Hawks.
Thank
Action
you,
reports.
Thank you, President Quigley. Action report 12.1 this evening is consolidated action report for certified and classified personnel. We're seeking your approval on 25 items for certified personnel and 23 items for classified personnel.
Motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, seeing none. Roll call vote, please.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
President Quigley?
Yes.
My second action report this evening is 12.2, resolution number 1530. We're asking the board to approve the authorization of dismissal of educational support personnel employees for reasons other than reduction in force.
Motion?
So moved. Second.
Motion and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, seeing none. Roll call vote, please.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
President Quigley?
Yes.
And my final action report this evening is 12.3, resolution number 1531. We're recommending the Board of Ed consider for approval and adopt the resolution approving the retirement and settlement agreement that we've proposed.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, seeing none. Roll call vote, please.
Member Boudouris?
Yes.
Member Campbell?
Yes.
Member Felice?
Yes.
Member Perrell?
Yes.
Secretary Sikora?
Yes.
Vice President Hanson?
Yes.
President Quigley?
Yes. Next, legal services report. Oh, I'm sorry. School board liaisons. Superintendent information report.
Yes, Mr. Quigley. At the direction of Member Campbell, I'd like to present information report 13.1, student liaisons to the school board. The proposal is we're proposing a pilot program for the 2015-2016 school year to utilize more student involvement with the school board. The idea would be to spend this year seeing what works and what doesn't, with a plan to create a permanent school board policy for the future. Our goal is for more input for a broader cross-section of high school students to enable the school board to make more well-informed decisions, to allow students to learn about how the school district and school board works, to help students learn about the importance of board decisions and more about civic engagement. The selection process that we are proposing are 2 to 4 students will be selected with an application process created by the Board of Education. Any junior or senior student can apply for a position. It will not be limited to student council or any particular student group, so any student may apply that's a junior or senior. The board will try to select students with diverse interests and involvement to get a broader student perspective on issues. Criteria for selection will include interest level, involvement in activities, and ability to attend meetings. The board president will assign 2 board members, the superintendent, and a high school administrator to review applications and make a recommendation of student liaisons to the board. The expectations for the students are the student liaison position is advisory to the school board and a non-voting position. The student liaisons will serve for one school year. They will be required to attend monthly school board meetings from September to May, but will not be required to attend work sessions. Not every student liaison needs to attend every school board meeting. The students can rotate attendance depending on the agenda or topics. The input for student liaisons will be early on the agenda, and students will not be expected to stay for the entire board meeting. The board will strive to accommodate student input within the first 30 minutes of each board meeting. And a high school administrator will coordinate details between the student liaison and the school board. The suggested timelines for this for the liaisons are: the board approves the process at the October 13th, 2015 school board meeting. The applications are made available to students as soon as possible after process approved, if approved by the board. The application due date would be October 26th, and a review of applications by the committee between October 27th of 2015 and November 13th of 2015. And then the selection of the students to attend the November 16th, 2015 board meeting. If you have any questions at this time, I'd be more than willing to answer them. Again, this information will be brought back for action at the next school board meeting.
It's put together very well. I like the points that you're bringing out here and how we'll use the students. I think it'll be good.
Thank you. I just would like to reiterate, this is not a duplication of what we had in the past, where students would approach the podium and give a rendition of current events.
Yeah, right. Current events, right. Thank you. Moving down the agenda. Legal services. Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, legal services.
No formal report.
AFT report.
Good evening, senior leadership and Board of Education. I'm Claudine Sharko, the Vice President of the Valley View Council. I just wanted to share some things that we're doing in the community as part of the union. The Valley View Council doesn't just consist of teachers. It's our nurses, it's our maintenance, it's our security, and our paraprofessionals. And as the Vice President in the second year in a row, we decided, again, to walk in the Bolingbrook Parade celebrating the 50th anniversary. It was very exciting to be so well received by the community and people cheering for their teachers, and we were dancing for the kids. We passed out bookmarks, pencils that said we love our students, and candy as well. We didn't do the Romeoville Parade this year because Greg and I, who is our Valley View Council President, had another union obligation. However, we have been invited to some fundraising events for Mayor Noak in October, so we'll be attending that as well, and also doing some other events in Romeoville. So we're trying to service both of our communities. And I also want to say for Hector's Heroes, I think that's such a worthy cause. I've been a teacher at Humphrey for 16 years, and I'm also a leader of Humphrey Helping Hands. And coming from a single parent family, I understand your financial struggles. And what we do is we try to, during the holiday season or when families are in crisis, donate money, gift cards, winter coats, whatever. So I'm going to be bringing this up to the Executive Council in October, and I would really like to give some support to you. So thank you for sharing that, and thank you for everything.
Thank you. Anyone else? Valley View Council. No report. Valley View Office Personnel Council. No report. Any old business before the board this evening? Any new business before the board this evening? Bob, here's your big chance. Come on down.
I'll my apologies, really. I'm sorry, because I did kind of rush this. I just got off a plane from Virginia to here. I didn't want to miss this board meeting, mainly because of one item. I was interrupted by the boss.
So back to where you left off.
Right, that's where I left off. But what I was about to say was that, you know, I'm very pleased as a resident, as a property owner, as a 25-year resident of Romeoville. I'm very pleased with the school district. So with that said, I want to make sure that I put that out there before I say what I'm about to say. Over the last 3 months or so, I'm very involved in athletics, as many of you may or may not know, very involved in athletics. And I was very thrilled when I found out that the school board hired Oliver Gibson as our football coach in Romeoville, both for personal and professional reasons. I'll start with the personal reasons and the fact that he is a Romeoville resident. He is a graduate of Romeoville High School. He has the respect of, you know, many people that don't necessarily show up at these board meetings in the community. And I think he's a success story that is very rare and hard to find in today's day and age, especially in Romeyville. It's been a struggle. The last 7 or 8 years, we just talked about how the economy has hit us all. You know, it's good to see somebody from our community with all the success that he's had at Notre Dame, at the Pittsburgh Steelers, at the Cincinnati Bengals. I mean, the guy has made a tremendous impact outside of Romeyville, and he's brought some of that knowledge back. He also did a great job in Evanston. I've done a lot of research on what he did while he was at Evanston with the kids, and I have read several articles from the Sun-Times, the Tribune, among other local papers that all, you know, spelled out this glowing review about how great it is and what he's done for their community. I'd like to think that he's going to do the same for ours. So, and barring the wins and loss records, because if you've ever read any of my articles, I'm not very big on wins or losses. I could really care less how many wins you had or how many losses you had. I want to know how many kids are going to go to college, how many kids are going to move and take something from a teacher. And just because you're a teaching professional does not necessarily mean that you're not a teacher. I think we're all teachers. This is a community. This isn't about, you know, 200 teachers and these are the only teachers. And so getting to my point, and I'll be brief, I've heard several people in town and had several conversations in town amongst people who don't have the flag to wave. Basically tell me that there's an issue still with one of the teachers at Romeyville High School, and I'm not privy to this, so I'm sorry I'm speaking in generalities, but that's all I know, is that there are apparently one or more teachers that have challenged this hiring, which I think is very lame, to be blunt. The fact of the matter is, it's not about whether or not Coach Oliver Gibson is a teacher, you know, in terms of being a hired professional inside the school building. Because if that were the case, then I'd like to think that the person who is making these claims, who is now coaching at Plainfield Central, he's not a teacher at Plainfield Central, but that's okay. It's not okay, though, for Oliver Gibson, who's not a teacher here in Romeyville, to coach. I think that's the argument that's been brought up in town. And I can tell you that I'm speaking to, you know, the whole board here, that you've made the right decision, I believe, in hiring Oliver, and I hope that you'll dig your heels in like I intend to do, because if he's going to get run out of town over a contract dispute, I can tell you this, I'm going to use everything in my power to fight that, everything. That means if I have to go door to door, I will. Right is right and wrong is wrong. And I always take the side of the teachers. I'm a big union supporter, always have been, people know that of me. But in this case, right is right and wrong is wrong, in my opinion. And that's what I'm here to do tonight, is just to speak up, because I think there are many parents right now that I can tell you that are afraid to speak up because they're afraid of some sort of a retribution against their children at the school, which is horrible. Horrible for any adult, any taxpayer in this city to feel that they can't speak up in protection of their kids, whether it's implied or not, is wrong. So I would hope that if this issue is still there, that you guys take it seriously and that the union sits down with you guys and you guys work it out. But I think that we're supposed to be here for what's in the best interest of the kids, not necessarily what's in our best interest. So obviously when it comes to my wallet, I'd like to think it's in my best interest and I want to keep it there. But the reality is I'm here for the kids. I believe that you guys did the right decision in hiring him, and I hope that the teachers union will do the right thing in supporting that hire. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. By the way, there's no one should feel like that they can't address an issue with their kids. And thank you for speaking on behalf of that community. I certainly understand where you're coming from. So thank you.
If I just may make one point. Mr. Leach, we appreciate your passion concerning this issue. The only thing that I would argue is that in defense of our teachers, I would say that no parent needs to feel fear for coming forward as a result of potential retribution. We've spent the last 5 years building a staff that we perceive to be very caring for our kids. Absent this particular issue, I can tell you with confidence that if in fact parents want to voice their opinion, there will be no retribution from our teachers. Not because I at the podium as a superintendent, say so, but because of the quality and character of our teachers in this district. And I just wanted to make that point clear. I wanted to separate those two issues because there should be no reason why they should fear expressing their opinion.
Thank you, Dr. Mitchum. Any other questions from the public or comments? Seeing none, any announcements by the board? Any announcements by the administration? Any announcements by the public? A motion would be in order to return to executive session for the purposes of employment, compensation, discipline, performance, dismissal of employees, and pending probable litigation.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Have a great evening, folks. Thank you for coming out.